to join this session. There is already 1530 hours. So we have Yamini with us. Hi Yamini and hi Muskan.
Hey Johnny. Hi.
And today we are going to witness a very, very powerful session, everyone. It is going to be a very powerful discovery about and on the functional collection in SCADA. Something very unique, something which is out of the box, and I'm sure and very confident that we are all going to siphon out at least one bit of learning from the expert lenses of Muskan and Yamini. So before we start, I would like Yamini and Muskan to share a little brief about the idea that what made you choose and select this topic, which is functional collection in SCADA, and how exactly it is going to help me as a listener, as a participant, as a learner, that how best I can utilize and implement this learning interaction.
Yeah, sure, Johnny. Actually, as we all know that we are majorly working on Scala, and which is a functional programming language. May not be purely functional, but it is a functional programming language. So all of us know about the old-fashioned collections, but there is something different that we are going to discuss, that what's fancy in this functional collections. So I'm not going to brief about the functional collections now, otherwise it will spoil the whole idea, but yeah, it is going to be a fruitful session, I hope.
All right, that's absolutely great. Can we wait for one minute more, Yamini and Muskan, because I can see people are joining us, and this also reflects an element of curiosity and passion, of course.
Yeah, sure.
Just as if we start the session before they could join. And equally, I would also like to encourage and request everyone to try and join these sessions 1 minute prior to the scheduled time. So if the joining time or the start time of the session is 2:30, which is 3:30 p.m. So let's try and challenge ourselves to join the session at 3:29 p.m. So that we can start on time and we also end on time. And there are, yes, I can see the practice heads and the team managers who have joined here. Would like to request once more. And once again, every one of us, that if you can encourage and ask our fellow team members and colleagues to join the session, as today's session is going to be very different, very unique, and out of the box. And I'm sure this is going to be so interesting that we are at the end of the session, we all been able to collect one or two, which is implemented. So yes,
pretty excited to start it. Meanwhile, I just want to say happy birthday to Prabhat. He's also there. So since we all are here, just want to take this opportunity.
Thank you for the wish. Thank you.
Yeah, enjoy your day, Prabhat.
Yes, thanks, Ravindra, and happy birthday to Prabhat once again. And coincidentally, this is, I'm sure this is going to be a birthday gift to Prabhat, because the topic that we have chosen and selected for this session for today is actually from Scala itself. So that's a recent gift from all right. So yes, Yamini and Muskan, over to you now. So since 80 of us have already joined, and would also request you to kindly record this session.
Yeah, sure. Muskan, can you please? Yeah. Yes, and so my screen is visible?
Yes.
Okay. Just a moment. Let me request. Okay. So, can I start now, Johnny?
Yes, young. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. So, hello everyone. Welcome to today's enlightening knowledge session. I and Muskan are going to present on the topic functional collections in Scala. Almost all of us know what good old-fashioned Scala collections are, either in Python, Scala, or Java. But still, what does this fancy functional collections means? Well, that's what we are going to know in the upcoming slides. So before getting started, let's move on to the knowledge etiquettes. First things first, punctuality. You are requested to join the session within the 5 minutes post the session start time, and keeping yourself on mute unless you have some queries. And it is always better to leave a constructive feedback for the presenter so that he or she can be better next time. So moving on to the agenda. So this is today's agenda. I'm going to cover data structures and objects, collections, collections hierarchy in Scala, whereas Muskan is going to cover functional look at collections, followed by an amazing demo and a fun-filled short quiz. So what are data structures and objects? Muskan? So, data structures are exactly what we learned right after college to land a job at an IT company. So, keeping that aside, what data structure is how we represent the data in memory. And data structures expose only data and they have no meaningful functions. And what I mean by that is data structures are just meant to store the data in memory, and how we are going to perform any computation to on those data structures can vary based on an individual or based on even every instance. You can change it effortlessly. Whereas if we talk about objects, how objects are different to data structures. So objects hide their data behind abstractions. Basically, in an ideal situation, you should not be aware of the data implementation, how the data is stored, how anything about data. You are just familiar with the computations that you are going to perform on that data. So why we are talking about data structures and objects, whereas the topic of the session is functional collections? Well, you will see that collections are a great combination of data structures and objects. So collections, what exactly collections are? Anyone who would like to answer that question? Anyone? Okay, no worries.
It's kind of a similar kind of a data pool, right?
I'm sorry? Pardon?
I mean, this is just like you have something similar objects, right? Then you can bind those together, right? For iteration or something.
Okay, okay. That is partially correct, but let's see what exactly. Anyone else?
Yeah, I would like to say something. So, collection is basically a group of heterogeneous objects.
Heterogeneous objects, okay. Would you like to shed some more light on it?
I mean, heterogeneous objects means the objects can be of different types. Like in arrays, we have homogeneous elements. And in collection, we can have data. Objects of different types. For example, like we can have a collection having elements of integer type, string type, or any other data type or class.
I'm sorry, but I need to correct you. Can you have a collection which hold integer as well as string?
This can only be possible in tuple, but not in list. List contains elements, homogeneous elements, not heterogeneous elements.
But fifth gen languages support this.
You can actually store any, right? So in Scala you can store any, and then you can store any kind of collection there, right? It basically depends on your list type.
Yeah, exactly. That was the whole point. I was going to say that if you take the parent type of string and int, then you can have it contained in one collection. So let's see what our polls say so this is pretty much the picture if you see in the knowledge channel that we shared the poll. But as far as the trend goes, we noticed that most of the people clicked on yes and then they moved to no. Maybe they read about it. So well, 30% of us still think that collections is just about holding elements, alright? But what is the reality? Collections hold a lot of complex properties. I'm going to emphasize on the complex properties here rather than holding just the elements. So I have another question for you people. What makes a set set? If you understand my question, so I want to know if any one of you know what makes set a set. Anyone?
So all the elements are unique, right?
Yeah, exactly. So can we do that only without defining these rules or these properties? We cannot just restrict a data structure to be only a set or only a queue. That's the whole point. A data structure, above it we can have n number of layers. We can let's say a set can be implemented as a hash map, or I can also implement a set as an array or a list a queue or any of the data structure. But how these complex properties are defined, this makes a collection collection. So moving on, so the whole point of the poll was who thinks that collection holds elements. If we look at the hierarchy of the collections, can anyone spot where we are storing the data? What does this hierarchy means, or what does this hierarchy states? As most of us know Scala and even collections in Java, it is basically the similar picture as in Java and in Scala. So can anyone point me where I can find the data here? Actually, this is the question to those 30% people who said that okay, collections are storing data. Okay, no worries. So basically, this framework tells us about the architecture of the data structure and how we are going to access that data. What are the restrictions on that data? And what are the complex properties we have defined on that data? Sequence, what makes sequence a sequence? Or what is making a map a map? So map is, if a map, let's make it more simple. We get to know that set holds only unique elements, and map can have same keys. Do you think so? Anyone who thinks map can hold same keys?
I don't think map can have
So this is something, these complex properties are basically defined in the collections. So moving, starting from the traversable, what traversable says that it's basically a trait and it defines how we are going to traverse on the data structure. So it basically defines the for each function. On the other hand, the iterable gives us a function iterator, which tells us that how we are going to iterate on that collection one by one. So each class that implements iterable has to provide the implementation to the iterator function. So this is what basically is the collections hierarchy, and to clear the picture what exactly collections are. So from here I'm going to hand over to Muskan, so she can just lighten up with the other stuff and what she has here.
Thanks Yami. From here I'll continue with the functional look at collections. So basically till now we know what is collection, okay, and how collections, data structures, objects are different from each other in some way, right? So now we know that collection actually doesn't hold the elements, okay? It holds the properties. That is the main part. Now I'll give you a functional look at the collections, and to make it more understandable, let's look at something first. Let's look at the function first. Okay, this is a very simple function here. Which will tell me if the number is given or not, right? This is a very simple code. Okay, and to call this method, what I'll do, I'll just call it like this, the name of the method, and I'll pass the parameter. Simple. The function is callable, right? You all know that. Now, let's look at the set, which is one of the collections that we have, right? Now, here I have created a set, named it null set, simply, right? And let's say I use null set and pass 2 here. This way I call its apply method. In Scala, the apply method can be called directly without even writing apply, right? And this way I call its apply method, and set apply method just tell us if that element exists in that set or not. Okay. So now if you see, do you see any similarity between these two things? Here I am calling a function, and here also I am calling somehow the set. Do you see any similarity here? What I wanted to say is, here we can see that this function is callable in the simple way, right? And in the similar way, if you see, this null set also becomes callable. If you just don't focus on this function and this set, you will see that the structure of calling is even, and null set, it's pretty much same. Both of them are common. And if it's callable, it could be functional, right? That a function is callable, right? So if it's callable, it is functional. That is how we can see that a set is functional. And to prove it, to prove my point, let's go and see something. Okay, let me create a class here and let me show you something. Okay. Let's create a normal set here, and then we'll see. Okay. So for example, I have a set here. Let's see which traits this set extends in Scala, right? So if I drill down, I'll see it extends this immutable set. If I drill down this set, I'll see it extends some another set. Okay. And here it extends this base rate for immutable set collections, and then we have this collection set. And if I go here, I'll see it extends multiple other things. And then here in the setOps, the last thing I see is it extends a function. This is a representation of a function, right? And it extends a function which takes A and then Boolean. Now, right, from this hierarchy, we can see that a set extends a function. And if a set extends a function, it can be called a function as well. That is, it is functional. In one word. That is a functional look to a collection. Am I clear? Or do I need to explain it more?
Mushkan, I think this depends upon the implementation of maybe the type or whatever you say here set, right? Because this has been implemented like this, right? Set can return some object that is having some functions, right? And that's why it's functional, right?
Yes, exactly. See, that is what I'm telling you. That in Scala, the set is basically one of the collections, right? Mm-hmm. And in Scala, it is implemented in this way that it is extending a function, it is calling, and that makes it a function itself. Or maybe you can call it functional itself. Mm-hmm. Right? Yes, exactly. Now we have mainly two other collections as well. One is sequence and another one is map. Let's look at them as well. Okay, can we call them also functional or not? Okay, let's look at them as well. So here is a sequence. Okay, and if I create a sequence and I call it supply method, right? So its supply method will return me the element, whichever the element on this index. So basically, if I call sequence with 0, it will go and check what is the element at 0th index and return me that. So here at the 0th index, I have 800, right? And for example, if I call the sequence 80 and my sequence doesn't have these many indexes, okay? So it will give me out of bound, right? So what I can see here that if I call a parameter on sequence, then either it returns me the element on the basis of the index, right? Or either it returns me exception that, okay, it doesn't know what to do with this index. It can't find that index, right? So, do you guys remember anything related to function which is callable, but which will only return me a solution, or basically, which will only return me an element on a defined domain? Do you remember any such concept that you have read about? Do you guys remember partial functions? A partial function is something which is defined on a limited domain. Okay? And it works only on that domain. So if we see, we can take sequence like that. That sequence is defined on a range of index only. Maybe from 0 to 20, 0 to 80, or whatever. And it only returns me the element on that defined index. Now, let's see if Scala also shows me something similar. Okay. Let's create a sequence here. Okay, and now let's try to drill down and see what the sequence extends. Okay. So here it is extending some another sequence which is extending this collection sequence. Okay, and this collection sequence extends partial function, which again makes this sequence functional, right?
Okay, so Muskan, you want to say that the collections that are defined in Scala, they can act as a function also. And instead of considering them only just as a collection, you can use them as a function also. Is that you are trying to say?
You can consider them basically they implement function, right? So you can consider them as that way as well. Okay. Basically, this is a different view of it. Like
So it is like helping you to reduce the code. You can say one thing.
Okay. So now map is simply a collection of key value pair, right? having unique keys and value pair, right? So, if I call the apply method of map, basically this makes it callable, right? So, what will be the result? It will be basically I will provide it a key and it will return me with the value corresponding to that key. Okay, that is how map works in Scala. And now, if I call the map with a key which is non-existent, basically which is not in the map, it will just return me no such thing. So here we can see that for some keys it will give me an output, and for some it will just give me that this key does not exist. So is it somehow similar to what I explained here and what I explained about partial function? Again, this is defined on a limited, right? Or only for some, and not for all of them, right? And if we see here, for example, if we drill down a map, we can see that. Let's see. If we drill down the map, we can see that extends mutable map, then there's another map, and here it implements this map ops, and here we can see that it implements this partial function again. And partial function in itself is kind of a function, right? So These are the main collections that we have in Scala, right? And for all of them, they have seen that they are somehow functional. They implement functions and they work on them. The apply method that we get here is from the function they are implementing. Okay. So I have a question. So when we create the variable map, so internally, the compiler creates a function, a getter function with map.
Method name map, and same way if you do map me comma some value, it will add instead of getting, it will add, right? It will do both things. I don't get your question. I'm saying, what internally happens? Like, there is a method called map when we compile our classes, Scala class, then we'll have map method also internally. Like, how this is working? How map bracket me is working internally?
So basically, in Scala we have this thing that rather than calling this apply method, okay? This is apply method which we get. And if you drill down a lot, you will get it that this we get from a function, okay? So basically, in Scala, we have this provision that rather than calling the supply method, we can just use this class. And that's it. So internally, compiler will call its supply method and work on it.
Okay, so when we are saying map and passing one, yeah, in the slide, like you are passing V.
Yes.
Yeah. So through this line, the compiler will understand that, okay, I have to call map.apply method, or we have a method which internally have this statement called map.apply.
The compiler will understand that we are trying to call apply method. Okay, for example, if you see here, basically, okay, let's go to apply. Okay, and here what apply did, it is implemented here in the map factory, right? We get it from here, and it is implemented. When I say that map 1, it understands that it is calling apply method. Okay, and it just executes whatever in that method.
So I think Jitendra, what you are saying is right. It will understand it as a statement and will go ahead and execute it.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay. So that was about the functional look at the collections. So I hope it was something maybe interesting, because when I found it first, it was interesting for me because I haven't looked at collections this way before. Yeah. Okay.
So, we are from Java, so we have not seen such things. So yeah, it is looking interesting for sure.
Okay, that is good. You will know Scala now as well. That is pretty much better. Okay. So now on demo. And in demo, we are going to implement a set ourselves. Okay. And in that set, I'm not going to implement a lot of functions now because it will take time and I don't have that much time, obviously. Right? So what we'll do, we'll just implement some basic methods, or we can say some basic properties that we will want in our set. Okay. So, First thing we want to see is check if a set contains an element. Okay, so let me define method contains, okay, which will be an element of type A, and which will return me boolean. If it is true, it doesn't false, right? And the apply method in the set do the same thing, that basically it checks if the element is true, right? So here I can just call the contains method and it will do the work. Okay. The other thing could be adding an element to a set. Okay. So add element to a set. Now for this, let's define a method plus. Okay, take an element. Obviously, if I remove something from a set, it will still return me a subset, right? So it will be not. This is my basic API.
So this is the and that's it.
Okay. So
hello, Usman.
Yes.
Can you please again explain the containment method?
Yes. So let's go to the containment method, right? And what the containment method is doing? It is checking if this element is in the system. Okay. Now the logic says if the element is equal to head. Either it will be the first element in the set, or it will be in the remaining set. Yes?
Yes.
And if any of that condition is true, then we have it and then we will return true, otherwise false. So what I am doing, I am checking if the element is equal to head, true, or if the tail contains head, then also it's true, otherwise false.
This
conditionality tail contains element. Oh, sorry. Okay, that is a mistake. Sorry. Okay, yeah, this is a tail contains element. It was my mistake. Sorry.
And yes. Just to check, Muskan, do we need the true else false? Without the if also, will it not suffice?
Yeah, it will work without the if also. So I just wrote it so that everyone can understand.
Yeah,
it will work without the if else also, because this is a condition itself which returns true or false, right? That's it. Okay, so that is all. Now what I'll do, I will create a object so that I can create an object of this null set easily. And then we will see if these methods work fine. Okay. And by the time I am writing the code for creating this null set, all of you please download Kahoot. Please. Because I have worked on that quiz a lot and I would really appreciate all of you participating in that. Thank you so much in advance. Okay. So I'll continue. So this is just a method that I'm writing so that I can create the null set easily. Okay. That's if anyone wants to understand this as well, I can explain it a little bit after writing this. Okay. What will you do? Okay, I think this is something with my ID and it should not give me this issue. I'll try to compile it first, see if it works. And meanwhile, what I'm doing here is basically I'm taking n number of input. Basically, you can provide any number of input here. Okay, while creating the null set. And what I'm doing, I'm calling this method here, create set. Okay, and what this method is doing, it is taking two parameters. Initially, I am passing the new empty set. So initially my set will be empty, and one by one I'll add all the arguments to it, right? That is what I want to do and create a set that way. So here initially I'll provide empty set, and here all the arguments. If the arguments are empty, basically I haven't provided any value there, 1, 2, 3, nothing. I haven't provided anything, so I will obviously get an empty set, right? So that's it will give me an empty set. Or otherwise, what I'll do, I'll call the create set again with the tail, basically the remaining sequence, and the first element will be added to the initial set. And this way, one by one, each element will be added to the initial set that was empty in the start, but in the end, it will be having all the elements. Okay, that is how I am creating this set. Now let's just create a main method, main object. Okay, let's run this code. Now set equals to okay, so this way simply because this way we are calling the apply method directly, okay, and here we are creating the null set. And for example, I can check if null set have one there. Okay, let me add print statement as well so that everyone can see the result. Okay, and let's add one more statement. So for 1 I should get true, and for 4 I should get false because 4 is not in the set, right? Let's run this code and see. Okay, so we can see that it is working perfectly, right? This way we can test other methods as well. And simply now we have created a set just by extending the function, and that's it. That was the demo. Anyone have any question regarding what I just presented?
Yeah, Muskan, can you add an element also by adding one again?
Yes, but to show you the result, the println, basically I will have to write one more method here for each. Okay, let me do it, just a moment. Okay, so first thing, I can add it like this way, simple, right. Yeah, but to show you the result, if I'll print it right now, it will return me something functional or something else, because the return type is null set, which is a trait and which is not converted to string directly. Okay, so for example, to show you this, let me do one thing, just a moment.
So the idea was to, it should return some error that it cannot accept one again, correct?
But it won't return error.
I mean, no? Like it should not add it as a duplicate value.
Yes, exactly. It should not basically add one again. Yes, you're right. Just a moment. Let me do this. I'll show you this. Okay. For each, if no. Let me think for the logic of for each. Just a moment. Method.
don't worry, Muskan, I got it. Like, it will definitely, because we have already written it.
It is not just striking me right now.
Yeah, of course. Okay. Don't worry. No.
Okay, cool. So yeah, it will work, but don't worry. Okay. Cool. Anything else? If no, then we can continue to the small short quiz that we prepared, and I hope it will be fun for all of you. Okay. So let's move to that then. Okay, so everyone, have you downloaded Kahoot? Kahoot, sorry.
So you gave web link also.
Yes. Right, okay. Yeah. It will work on web link as well. No problem. Okay. So here a game pin will be loaded. Okay. Please enter that game pin. Enter your name and enter the game. All the players will be shown on the screen, so please write your real name so that we can identify who, you know, won. Please enter the game pin and enter the game.
Okay. Muskan, what is the pin?
All right. 116.
116-7805. All right.
Yes, exactly. 116-7805. Yes.
I'm not going to win, so I'm here just for fun.
Okay.
Ravinder is already asking questions, so I think today you don't need me.
Oh, come on. Rahul.
Okay, now everyone can open their mic and, you know, enjoy the game. Because we are just having fun, and it will be a good, fun, and informative game, hopefully. Okay.
See, we have Michael Jackson.
Okay.
Who entered Michael Jackson?
Okay, let's wait for a few more minutes, and please everyone join fast so that we can start. Yes, exactly. Okay, let's give everyone 3 more minutes, and I think 3 minutes is enough for joining this game. If someone has not downloaded Kahoot, just go to the kahoot.it site and enter the pin and play from there.
So in the chat window, I have posted the link to Kahoot.
So you can directly join click on. You're also there?
Yes, I'm there.
Yeah, here he is.
I'll try my luck as well.
No, you can score. Don't worry. It won't be something different from what we discussed. Okay. 2 more minutes. And then I'll start. Just 32, come on guys, join.
Only 50% have joined.
Come on guys, this is a game. You can play a game, okay? I know session could be boring, but I don't think game is boring. So come on. We have Superman now. That is very nice.
So Muskan, let people join with any name. You will have more presence.
Okay, join with any name. Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Join with your favorite... Marvel or...
I can guess who Superman could be. I was talking to one person, you know, in the morning. And
come on, Johnny, you don't have to leak that information.
The beauty is that only 2 people now, I mean, could actually correlate that. Who am I indicating?
We have Batman now as well.
Yeah.
someone who want to name himself or herself Spider-Man?
Yeah. We have Wolverine as
well. Okay.
The sound is increasing. See.
Okay.
Please
so now.
With any name. No. No compulsion. No.
Okay. So 4:30. Should I start?
Yeah, I guess you can start. You should.
Okay.
Start.
Cool. I'm starting now. Okay. So we will have our first question right here. What is a data structure? You have to read the answer here and select the right color on your screen.
Oh my god.
Usually green signifies the correct answer. So
no cheating here, please. Please. No, no, no. Okay, so the 10 people gave the right answer and many of us didn't even answer. So guys, please hurry up. We have a timer here of 20 seconds. You will get only 20 seconds to answer it. Okay. And
can't see the timer.
Oskan, this is not fair because see, I said, I quoted the correct answer here, but I could not click on the answer in the tab. So
Johnny,
So 0 marks, Johnny. 0 marks.
Yeah, yeah.
No question asked. No
Johnny,
question.
I would recommend you to join a L&D session.
That was the good one.
All right, I'm going to score the next one. I'm sure.
Okay. Yami, you want to clear how we play this game? Just clear it once.
Wait a minute. And is it true that whosoever answers quickly gets more points?
Yes, exactly.
So if you answer it in 1 second, you will get probably 1,000 points. If you answer it on 10th second, you will probably get only 100 points. So be very sure.
Okay, and there could be multiple answers as well. Okay, but there could be. It is not for every question. Okay. So okay, let's move on and see who is on the top right now. That is great. That is nice. Okay, let's move on to the next question. This is a multi-select question.
What is an object?
Quicker. Only 12 seconds left and we have only 3 answers. Seriously, just 3 answers? Click anything if you don't know the answers. Oh, okay. So whoever selected yellow or blue, they both were correct. Okay, so you will get the points. Let's see who is on the top now. Prateek. Oh, nice one.
Wrong there.
Great going, Prateek.
Okay.
Thank you.
Let's go to the next question. Okay, it's a true or false, simple. And I think now everyone should know it.
Question time.
Collections hold elements. Is it true or false? Yeah. Great. Okay, still 50-50. Still okay, cool. What are you saying, Yami? Yeah. Okay. Let's see the scoreboard now. Prateek still on top, and I think if this way Prateek keeps scoring, he'll run away. Okay. Next question. So it's a quiz, and it's a multi-select. You can select multiple options right now. So what's a collection? Five more seconds. Great. Okay. Vaibhav on the top again. Okay. Let's move to the next question. There is no method named as call or callable. No. Okay, so apply is the right answer. And okay, Vaibhav is still on the top.
Yeah, I think nice. Vaibhav ka internet can disconnect karna padega. Remove karo Vaibhav ko.
It is about who chooses first and the right answer as well. So, hurry up. Okay, next one. What is at the top of the collection hierarchy in Scala? We showed you the hierarchy, right? So you should do this. Okay. People got confused between traversable and iterable and okay, it's fine. Okay. Let's see. Vaibhav still on top.
He's on fire.
Yeah, he's on fire. I think he's gonna win today. Let's see. Okay. Seventh question.
My fingers crossed this time.
Okay. But many of you answered it right. That is pretty good. Okay. So let's see. Vaibhav is still on top. And now we are left with, I think, three questions more. 8, 9, and 10. And let's see, what do you say, list is functional or not? For those of you who don't know, list is a type of sequence. Yeah, nice.
Got it. I got nice. It.
great. Okay. So Vaibhav, you need to, I think, talk up now because people are approaching you. If you need want to talk, you need to talk up. Okay. Last second question. Array is not a data structure. Is it true or false?
I got it once again.
Right. So array is a data structure. Okay, that is the point. Okay. So now let's see who is on the top, and it's Vaibhav. And I think now Vaibhav is going to win. The next question is a bonus question, and it will give you double points. Okay. Read it carefully and answer it. It's a multi-select question, okay? And so it's a simple question. Did you like this quiz? That's it. Now it. So everyone is right, right? Okay. And let's see who comes third. Rafael. I don't know who. The person is Yash Gupta, and on the podium we have Iron Man. Okay. Vaibhav. Where is Vaibhav? I thought here we will see Vaibhav. Okay, nice. So, who is Iron Man? Now, Iron Man can tell us who is Iron Man.
I am
Iron Man.
I don't know, you guys are going to believe me or not.
So, everybody is Iron Man.
Yeah.